So let me just give a little bit of background. I kind of met Chris in the most lovely of ways, but kind of in the most random of ways. You know, people ask, like, do you need to move to Hollywood, right, to actually work in the business? And the great thing about, you know, the new low-cost digital technologies is you don't necessarily need to do that. I mean, heck, you could make your own movies and monetize them on YouTube if you knew how to do it and connect with your audience. But one of the nice things about living in Hollywood is that you bump into people that work in the industry and you make relationships and friendships, and our daughters know each other. And we were at an event together, and I just sort of casually said to Chris, I was telling him, I'd already told him about ASU, the most innovative school in the nation, and how excited I was to work there, and how we had had a professional come and teach our students named David Stump, who had actually worked on a feature film that we did with our students. And he said, Yeah, I know David Stump. I've known him for a long time. And then all of a sudden the dots connected and we started talking more, and I discovered what I came to discover, at least what was for me, was like the best kept open secret in Hollywood. This amazing visualization company that was doing work that will astonish you, and which you're going to get to see tonight, just how close this visualization and pre-visualization work that they do, how close it is to the actual movie. And I just fell in love with this company and wanted to learn more and more and more. And then we decided, okay, we're doing this whole superhero movie question semester, our superhero movie cinema. And turns out Chris had worked on quite a few of those. And as a company, he had built a company, not just of technicians and programmers and coders, but really a team of filmmakers, right? And for those here in the class tonight, you remember Scott Derrickson talking about working with the Third Floor on Marvel's Doctor Strange, and how Chris's team contributed enormous amounts of creativity to that film. And so I thought, who better to explore this question of our superhero movies cinema and somebody that worked on a lot of these superhero movies, true filmmakers, but also incredible programmers, coders, and real innovators in the industry. And that is the Third Floor. We're going to learn all about the Third Floor. We're going to learn all about Chris Edwards. I'd like everybody to turn on your microphone, please. And let's give Chris Edwards a big Sun Devil welcome. All right, come on. Chris, thank you.
Well, first of all, I got to introduce our company mascot. This is Wampa. So if there's any Star Wars fans out there, he's a living, breathing Wampa mixed with an Ewok. And he's delightful and very, very popular.
Are you at the headquarters?
He's the real boss. What's that?
Are you at the Third Floor headquarters right now?
No, I'm coming to you live from the home headquarters of Third Floor right now. We're all working from home and very productively, actually. We have over 300 employees and worldwide, and we're all working together, still making Hollywood movies somehow. It is going pretty well, actually. So I'm so honored to be here, Adam. Thank you so much for the gracious introduction to all the people on this stream that made this possible. I love talking to students because, you know, you guys are the next generation. You guys are the ones that are going to be creating the Mandalorians of the future and whatever content that you want to bring to this world. So hopefully I can show you a little bit about what we're doing in the context of creating some of these movies that you're debating so fiercely. And so what I wanted to do is maybe switch over to a little screen share. I have a presentation for you guys. So let's see if that works. And we will go and share this one. And hopefully you guys are now seeing this.
Yeah, I believe it's working.
Wonderful. So you guys see some videos. Wonderful. There will be question time later on, plenty of questions. So cue all those up as you go. This is just some of the work that we've done over the years. And usually we have the honor of working on moments like this one from Dr. Strange, your new best friend, Scott Derrickson, who is the director of that movie, was here just last episode, last class, when he was describing how we all work together. So I'd like to give you a deeper dive into how that all works, and then we can all summarize and draw the conclusions at the end about whether or not these films are, you know, artful and meet or exceed the bar of cinematic style and quality to be officially called cinema. So moving forward, I'm Chris Edwards, and I'm one of the six co-founders of this company that was created on the third floor of George Lucas's Skywalker Ranch House. So you two can spread the word. If you run into anyone, please help me clarify this. It's supposed to be a little mysterious. The logo is based on us working a little too hard, a little too late for George. And that's what you see here. So we're celebrating now over 15 years of being our own company. This is outside of the days we were just working at Lucasfilm. We decided to come down to Los Angeles and start our own company that has been has become the world's largest visualization studio in the world, helping directors plan their visions in real time. And we've done that on so many different productions. Usually we touch over 100 a year. Believe it or not, most of those are feature films, although increasingly we're seeing more and more OTT or television series that meet or exceed the quality of feature films. And lots more where that came from, which I will explain later. So every year, if you look at the box office of the top 10 highest grossing movies in North America, usually they contain seven or eight of the films that we contributed substantially to, as you can see here from 2017. And also into 2018 and 2019, here's a couple of select films that we had a lot to do with. So I wanted to start by telling you a little bit more about who I am, because for me, this is a kind of a personal journey. Not only to create the company, but for the motivation that drove me to want to create the company and how that's related to our central topic of this class in terms of creating cinematic quality storytelling. So there was this conference that I was invited to very recently and honored to receive a little award there, which is sort of like a lifetime achievement award. Although I told them I couldn't win a lifetime achievement award because I'm not nearly done with my life, you know, knock on wood. But it was really nice for them to honor some of the work that we had done over the years. And so I had this excuse to put together a little documentary on my life. And I, since I had it and no one's ever seen it before, unless you were there on the day in Paris, I thought I'd show it to you guys right now. So here we go.
Chris Edwards was born in 1974 in Maryland. The son of a costume designer and a rocket scientist, he was influenced as much by construction sets and early computer graphics as he was by art, animation, and classic cinema. One day, Chris's mom brought home a mysterious book from the local library. Industrial Light and Magic, The Art of Special Effects, showed Chris how pioneers like John Dykstra, Phil Tippett, and Dennis Muren had combined technology and art to make incredible visuals come to life. From then on, Chris's mission in life was clear. 1. Go to film school. 2. Work really hard. 3. Join George Lucas, Steven Spielberg, and other ambitious filmmakers in their pursuit of innovative visual storytelling. After graduating in 1997, Chris was hired as one of six 3D workbook artists at Walt Disney Feature Animation, responsible for pre-planning every shot in Disney's Dinosaur. Chris's broad range of skills served him well when he was invited up to Skywalker Ranch to help enhance THX 1138, the George Lucas director's cut, on the third floor of Lucas's Victorian mansion. Renovating THX to George Lucas's satisfaction was their trial by fire, and the reward for planning, acting in, and delivering more than half of the final visual effects for THX 1138 was the opportunity to help Lucas design thousands more shots for Star Wars Episode III, Revenge of the Sith. Later, Steven Spielberg joined the fray to guest direct several key Episode III action sequences via the team's unique 3D animatics process. After 2 years at the ranch, Chris inspired the majority of the third floor artists to join forces as equal partners. And in October 2007, the Third Floor Inc. was established as an artist-driven studio in Los Angeles, California. And studio by studio, film by film, the Third Floor's workforce and reputation grew, from Valkyrie to the Narnia series to winning the opportunity to visualize practically every Marvel film since the original Iron Man. And yes, to return to support Lucasfilm on their recent Star Wars films and streaming series. These days, the Third Floor has talented teams all around the world, working on award-winning episodics such as Game of Thrones, and more than 75% of Hollywood's blockbusters each year, including groundbreaking virtual productions such as Avatar, Gravity, and Avengers Endgame. For over 15 years, Chris has promoted real-time visualization as a universal art form that can be used to efficiently design architecture, commercials, video games, theme parks, and other forms of immersive entertainment, such as virtual reality and artificial reality. Chris is perpetually passionate about the Third Floor serving as a catalyst for creative collaboration. And even though he is the undisputed champion of professional visualization, he's primarily focused on making the visualization process more intuitive and accessible to students and the next generation of inspired creators.
That's you guys. That work for everyone, hopefully.
Woo! That's awesome.
All right. Thank you. Well, that's my life in a nutshell. But there's one thing that I did gloss over there, and it's the fact that my grandparents had a lot to do with this, too. They lived near Charlottesville, Virginia, and basically heard in a local newspaper that there was this film festival that was going to happen in 1992. And because my grandparents loved their grandson so much, and they had heard that I was into movies and stuff, they got me, they were first in line to get a ticket that was very sought after, which is a very small group of people who got to sit for 4 days hanging out with Roger Ebert, the famous film critic, to look at every scene shot by shot in Citizen Kane using a laser disc pointer, a laser disc player, and a laser pointer, so that he could keep it all rolling and make comments on the cinematography and all of the different aspects of cinema, film language. And that was the first moment that I actually realized how in-depth a director's job is and a cinematographer's job on making a film, and how much their choices mattered to the impact on screen, on the emotion of the audience, not only the arrangement of characters within the shot, but the triangular relationship of how they would all work inside the frame, how they that dynamic would move, different choices for lensing, compressing distance. All of these things were revealed to me at a very young age, and it blew my mind. So this is a picture from that event. And so really, it was my realization at that moment that filmmaking is a combination of conscious planning, very careful planning for specific shots, and also the happy accidents that are garnered from real-time collaboration with your crew, your friends, your contemporaries, everyone working together to make the collective artwork more compelling in the end. So also, oddly enough, Roger Ebert also wrote a big book on Scorsese. So he was also very into Scorsese's work, and so am I. And I think that everyone appreciates Scorsese's approach, which has been very innovative at times. There is a lot of unique camera work and storytelling devices and editing. That was, I think, signature Scorsese. So he definitely is creating cinema in his own right. So what I want to do, though, is take a couple steps back and go into Previs history. So Previs actually has an origin in storyboarding. So these are the actual storyboards from Alfred Hitchcock's famous Psycho scene, the shower scene. And just shows how carefully the director worked with his storyboard artist, Saul Bass, to not only compose each of these frames, but to rearrange them almost like a pre-editing process to make sure that he would get the most impact out of every second, every moment within this filmography before he even shot the film. And so what he was able to do is really push the limits of what at the time was censorship rules of how much skin you could show, of how much blood, of how, you know, different rules from the ratings committee to just skirt just under that regulation. And that's why it ended up becoming so impactful, so groundbreaking, and scaring a lot of people at the time, and became so popular. So it didn't take long for filmmakers to realize that they could use other things to help depict the framing of a shot and to plan the aspects of cinematography and staging. And so they said, well, why do we have to draw it all the time? Not everyone has good draftsmanship. So it was really with the advent of these little smaller cameras. I mean, we kind of take it for granted today that the tiny little cameras on our phone work so well. But this was a pretty fancy device at the time, which is these little lipstick-size cameras. They're like the size of a small flashlight. And that was finally small enough to actually use it with model miniatures. So you see here in The Return of the Jedi how the crew had used the action figures from the previous movie that they went out and bought at the store as a device to plan the scene. So let's check it out.
Rebels, we better report to the base.
Pull next to that guy.
And so after that scene went over so effectively, new techniques were being used and developed constantly to be able to pre-visualize movies. And this is the first time that they actually used a computer to actually map out the angles from the right perspective. And even though this looks like we're going way back into the past, like Tron level graphics, it was actually a step forward because instead of approximating the model miniature size, this one was actually using the real scale data of this amusement park to plan this composite shot of these two people flying over the landscape. It was a very important moment for this movie called The Boy Who Could Fly. And then there was the team over at Sony Pictures Imageworks and the also Columbia Pictures that were starting to use this as a way to do like chase scenes and different stunt effects. The computers were getting a little better. They could finally actually shade something. And so you can see here what looks like maybe, Super Nintendo graphics.
Edited version of the scene well before one frame of film was shot. Here we can see the dramatic similarities between the electronic storyboards and the actual film. Over 30 minutes of animation was generated for Three Rivers.
also, this was the culmination of this period of using computers to create visual effects in advance of the film. And so you see that this was George Lucas actually approaching this in an even more comprehensive way, using a combination of storyboards, puppets, live actors, and computer graphics. Whew, a little loud. And so this is the place where I came into the picture, because George had pioneered the extensive use of computer graphics for pre-planning films, something he called the 3D animatics process, and then later became known as pre-visualization or pre-vis. But I was invited, as you saw in the video, up to the third floor, which was a wonderful place to work. Honestly, there was not too many people there. It was just us and the guys over in what's called Skywalker Sound, doing the sound mixing, George Lucas and his editors. So every now and then we'd take a walk around the property, and this is some of the co-founders of the company. And we really did bond and then worked really hard, actually, during the day and sometimes at night. I had a sleeping bag under my desk just in case it got too late. And we did have some good times, and even made our own little newsletter because we felt isolated, just to keep the camaraderie going. But over the 2 years that we worked on three different films, and one kind of bled into the another. And here's just a sample of some of the frames that we contributed to in Star Wars Episode 3, which is kind of the culmination of our efforts there. So, as you can see, it was just a close working relationship between me, Eric, one of our co-founders, and George Lucas, and George Lucas's special friends, like Steven Spielberg, that would come in and help us design shots like this. One thing you'll notice there is just how similar the previs work is to the final results. And that's something that we really prided ourselves on, is to take the quality level to the next level, where we would be able to very accurately depict what was in the mind of the creator. What was in the mind of the creator is usually something specific in their head, but it took a little while to get out of their head. For example, this is a drawing from Steven Spielberg on the left side with Chewbacca, of course, jumping into a tank and obviously shooting some robot or some droids, and then Yoda jumping from pod to pod. We, after a while, became familiar with their little depictions, and we would use these sketches as well as a combination of those sketches and their verbal comments in order to get a good idea of what they're looking for. But we're really layering on top of that the film language that we learned in school, that we embodied, to help bring this to life in a more and more cinematic way, with real camera moves and real lenses that could actually shoot these scenes. By the way, these on the right are George Lucas drawings, including the famous George Lucas R2-D2 napkin that I still have. And anyways, you see that their quality of these drawings is not very good in terms of their draftsmanship, but their ideas were very potent and definitely a huge important part of these films. So we gathered together as a band of brothers and went from San Francisco, which is where Skywalker Ranch is, just north of there in Marin County, and down to Los Angeles, where we started our own company and very humbly grew the company from job to job, and eventually became the largest in the world. And these days we are duplicating all the amazing camaraderie we had up at the Skywalker Ranch by extending that to all the folks that we're blessed to work with, and creating, you know, quite a family, quite that has a lot of fun. And we have a lot of dogs and pets that come by. It's a really fun place to work. And I'm really ultra proud to show you guys this reel, which is hot off the presses. It's just some of our most recent work. Maybe you recognize some of the movies that we worked on here. Hopefully you like them. So here is the world premiere of our new demo reel. So check it out. Awesome. Well, thank you guys. Well, obviously it's a team effort, and we just created the first impetus to do this. And, you know, really it's about fostering the community and putting forward the best possible environment for people to create awesome things. And so that's where I'm kind of speaking from today, is just knowing what goes on behind the scenes when we're creating this type of content. There's a lot of really substantial conversations that we have with each director and their chosen crew members, usually the production designer, the editor, of course, the, you know, the cinematographer or DP. Everyone is working really, really hard to try to pack the most cinematic, you know, moments and meaning into these creations. And let me go a little deeper now into how this all works, and we'll look at some other more specific examples if you guys are game. Yeah. All righty. So let's go over here, and I'm going to share my screen once more. I'm going to get rid of those pop-ups, and we're going to start it down here. Okay. So when we do a film such as Avengers Infinity War, there is a script. The script is pretty good and all the basic components are there of the storytelling, but there's a lot left to the imagination. And that's where maybe what I'll do is actually describe it and then I'll play it. So what we do is we explore how to stage these scenes cinematically and try these scenes out probably 10 to 20 times. Every time putting new ideas, refining moments, and coming up with the ultimate shooting plan so that they know exactly how to inform the actors, how to what equipment to bring, how they're going to pull off shots in different ways, and that they're ultimately super confident that this is a scene that deserves to have a moment in the film. So let's just play this and just take special note of the sort of side-by-side comparison here, because over the years we started out a little rougher, but then around the time of these latest Avengers movies, we've been able to get it really quite dead on, including predicting what some of the effects would look like as a suggestion to final visual effects. So check this out. And as you guys know, some of these scenes are extra pivotal to the emotional storytelling as well and need to be vetted by, you know, just about everyone who touches the design of these scenes, including the costume designers, stunts. Of course, the actors get to see this and are able to play their roles a lot more effectively as well. So in order to put a scene like this together, we need to first block out the key action. And instead of just going and going crazy with the animation right away, we do a blocking pass. And that's what this is showing you now. So very, very rough, but we're concentrating on the composition, the staging, the important timing of events, and how that's going to work editorially through cuts. And then as we refine that idea, we can start upgrading the models. We do a little bit with the lighting. We have a little bit more reference to go on so we can refine the specifics of how the shot will play out. And this looks like your screen is going on hyperdrive, but really this is a 30 times speed fast forward through that little movie called BFG. Steven Spielberg directed Big Friendly Giant. And if you've seen the movie, it's a virtual production or a complete animated movie with actors that are in motion capture suits and pan animated other times. So in order to plan a movie like this that is all virtual, you need to do a pre-visualization of the entire movie. But just when I slow things down, like here during this moment, you can see just how carefully we pre-plan every single moment here. Even though this is not the final acting, we're planning out how the camera's orbiting around, pushing into her face. We see how the effects come across her face. Back to BFG, he's going to make this dream. And then the idea that came up just in collaboration with Spielberg was to have the shadows reflected on the wall and then to keep pushing in. And also, instead of cutting to the over-the-shoulder shot of her to see the BFG, we of course see him in the reflection there. So we've learned by working with really awesome filmmakers that think about these types of cinematic ideas or their mise-en-scene, they end up, you know, we've learned over the years just how clever you can be to capture attention in a meaningful way. It's not just about, is the action covered? It's about, what is the most impactful way to shoot this? And that's a combination of all the elements, including the camera in the end. So you have here a depiction of the entire process of visualization from very beginning in the early stages of development all the way through the final visual effects. And you can see here in the middle, this is when they actually do the shoot, and any kind of shooting endeavor is always the most expensive, most intense pressure cooker because there's more people involved, the actors are there. And this is where the visualization process needs to help out filmmakers in the form of what we call texts and virtual production. So within the visualization whole process, there are subcategories of viz because these are different stages, different moments that have a different focus of how we approach the visualization. So I'm going to go through some of that in a bit. But the idea is in general that if you can fix it in pre, you don't have to fix it in post. You know, you can put your post budget where the visual effects should be adding detail instead of fixing things that were done wrong. So this is where the planning part of my introductory comments comes in, right? We plan really, really well, and we help filmmakers channel their energy into those plans. One of the ways that we engage filmmakers is at the very earliest stage. It's a process called pitch viz. So this is like how filmmakers these days pitch their ideas to studios, to themselves, to investors, to even key cast members. So I'm just showing you a smattering of different pitch vizzes we've done, and they can be in many forms. It could be hand-drawn, it could be a scene that's a sample scene of what the director can direct. It can also be a teaser trailer for a movie that doesn't quite exist yet, but it feels like it exists. And it can be rendered in different ways, like you can see in the lower right-hand corner. This one's now rendered with a video game engine, so you get more detail in the reflection as opposed to more of a flat-shaded traditional pre-viz model. So I want to show you a couple of examples of pitch viz so you know how much, I guess, storytelling and design goes into an endeavor like this, even before it's a greenlit movie. So even Steven Spielberg has to audition his film projects for the full support of the financiers and the distributors. And so what he did with Ready Player One is he hired us to channel his storytelling ideas and become a real auteur of this particular sequence that he wanted to tackle first. And it was, you guessed it, the car chase sequence inside the Oasis. So check it out. So this is Ready Player One, the sequence before the movie existed. We were putting in all kinds of different ideas, even some Easter eggs from different Spielbergian movies. Of course, the reference to Bob Zemeckis and the DeLorean from Back to the Future. I think coming up soon, we might have a T-Rex show up. But there's so much layering of storytelling and of cinematic moments just for comprehension of what's going on, all of which have to be done and planned very carefully so that you can have the sequence continue in a way which is hypnotic and keeps you, even with the sound off, keeps things very, very compelling. So here's another example from a movie called Alita Battle Angel, Robert Rodriguez directing. And this was a fun one because he had access to some of the equipment that was post the original Avatar and before they had started tackling the new Avatar. But they had some really innovative tech and they wanted to use it on this story that Cameron had been pursuing for a long time, but he was a little busy with other things. So he gave the reins over to Robert Rodriguez and we tested out a couple of sequences in the form of a pitch viz. And so here's that original sequence that very few have seen.
Welcome to the underworld. From here, there are worlds above worlds above worlds. It's where I used to live.
And it's where you're going to die.
Dance a little, flea!
And for this one, we really wanted to capture the sort of original comic book or Japanese manga style of the artwork and of the anime that came later. And it was one of the driving forces behind the production to have this touchstone of like, wow, we could really pull that style off. And now, yes, let's proceed with the rest of the filmmaking. So it's an honor to be involved in that one. I wanted to talk to you about the whole process. You understand that kind of how we do this step by step. So yes, just like Alfred Hitchcock, we begin with some storyboards. We have in-house storyboard artists. They also edit those storyboards together with our editors, and that's what's called an animatic, using the terminology from George Lucas. But animatic to us is really storyboards in motion, set to music and sometimes voiceover. So you get a sense of the timing. Then we go into building the worlds or the locations. Sometimes locations are based on a real set that exists. Sometimes they're based on a set that you're going to build in the future if you really feel like you need it, or a portion of a set. And the third option is it's complete fantasy, all virtual location, or something in between. So for Avatar 1, we worked on building out the entire world of Pandora very early on. This was done by three of our artists. Working closely with the art department, aka the production designer's world. And that's where it was very carefully crafting every little aspect of this, but really not just designing rocks. We were designing rocks and trees and forms that would actually facilitate the and further the filmmaking and the storytelling, right? It's not just to make it look pretty. It's because we wanted a moment for the characters James Cameron wanted the moment for the characters to interact in a certain way that felt genuine and right to him, I believe. And therefore, we were complementing that vision with the visuals and making the situation work out that way. Because when everything's virtual, you can make it whatever you want. So I think why Cameron tends to lean in that direction, like many other filmmakers. So you don't need to build everything from scratch. We have this huge library of assets that we've built over the years of characters and props and crowds of characters, different visual effects, all real-time assets. So you can think of this as like a kind of a playground, a sandbox for filmmakers. They can come in. If they have a movie about a guy on a ship, we have a ship. We probably have, 25 ships. He or she can say, check this out. Yeah, oh, that's the type of galleon I want, but I want another mast and I want it longer and let's paint it blue. We can absolutely make that happen. But the point is you don't have to rebuild it. You can just augment and then that becomes a new asset. So now we have, tens of thousands of assets that we use. Some of those assets are the actual reproductions of film equipment. So it's like cameras and dollies and different camera cranes, including really fancy motion control apparatuses. So after you've built the world, the next logical thing is to start exploring it like a filmmaker would if you're going out and what's called tech scouting or location scouting. And we have fancy ways of doing that virtually. then it's all about, okay, well, now we have an empty set. It looks really cool, but it doesn't really make a film, does it? You really need to start putting in the action, the emotional underpinnings. It all comes from the actors and how you move the camera through that space to complement the actors and their performances. So you can use a virtual camera to shoot it from a million different angles and then decide, ooh, that's a great angle. That's where a lot of the happy accident starts coming in for us, even in pre-production, through virtual cinematography that we can do in advance. And of course, during the virtual location scout. Here's another example of how we then take all that data and move that to the set. We bring it with us when we're shooting these scenes or helping the filmmaker shoot these scenes. You could do an overlay of digital elements on top of the live action elements, like here with the Hulk, and it all comes together to inform the filmmakers of what it will look like eventually, even though it's just a rough draft of what that Hulk will look like. Ultimately, it's the post-viz that is the finishing pass for visualization teams. And this is all about how we creatively use the elements we have, both live action shooting elements that can be retimed, repurposed, different ways to composite, punch in, add characters to that, as well as you can also add virtual elements to that, like you see here with the robots, because there's a million different ways for the different Ultron robots to be placed and how are they going to interact with our hero. So you can see the level of attention that is given to every cinematic moment within a Marvel film, for example. And that's the best way so far to win an Oscar for visual effects. Here is a scene that is giving you a preview of what the studios see when we're in that cave. Okay. This is after they've shot these scenes. It could be just a day or two after they shoot these scenes. We're giving them a version of the sequence back, or we're working with the editor sometimes to feed them the footage that has a composited pre-vis element or post-vis element put back into the plate or the cinematography. So you see a rough preview of what that final image will look like. In this instance, it's Captain America Civil War, I think. And they had this big confrontation scene that's in the middle of this airport. Only problem was they couldn't really shoot at the airport. It's really tough to get permission to do that. And so long story short, they decided just to shoot it in the parking lot next to the sound stages where they were shooting everything else, so they could just have lunch and then waltz over and shoot a couple of elements and call it a day. And so you'll see that the whole airport and everything except for a couple of boxes of crates and a few machines or equipment that they borrowed from the airport, everything is all digital.
Does not obey the laws of physics at all.
Look, kid, there's a lot going on here that you don't understand.
Mr. Stark said you'd say that. You also said to go for your legs.
Quick, can you get him off me?
Buckled in.
Oh, I pretty much hate you right now, Arrow guy.
Stark tell you anything else?
That you're wrong? You think you're right? It makes you dangerous.
Guess he had a point. You got heart, kid. Where are you from?
Queens.
Brooklyn.
Many times the scenes that we're creating are, you know, action oriented, but they are based on the human emotional conflict that's happening between not only the good guys, but the bad guys and just about anybody in this story on how they're all reacting to the situation around them. So, you know, it requires the same level of production design, the same level of attention that even, you know, sort of a dramatic movie would require. And so we give it that same level of attention. I want to touch a little bit on TechViz because it may not be obvious, but we also interpret the creative work that is approved after we've created it, and we then mine that for all the data. All of these diagrams that you're seeing are measurements and camera angles and little charts that show how scenes and setups are planned and done oftentimes in layers. Sometimes you need to shoot the dragon pass and the person riding the dragon separately and then composite her on top of this other background plate that includes the extras and the other key cast members reacting to that. It gets pretty complicated pretty quick. So we use the TechViz to break all of that down into doable chunks, but it all comes from the grand vision from the director. And so here is the results. Even though this is a television show and we don't have nearly the budget or the time allocated to a feature film, we're doing rough blocking of the action, and it still makes a pretty profound impact on a signature moment within Game of Thrones. And we worked on Game of Thrones from tail end of season 3 all the way through season 8, and every year it just got more and more complicated. So check this out. Every time we approach a scene like this, we're thinking about all of our influences from other movies, just like any other filmmaker would, and go, you know, what kinds of dramatic shots and choices can we make to really pump up the drama in the sequence? And I think we're really proud of how Game of Thrones gave us a lot of opportunities to just really hype up that drama to a new level. I want to show you this sequence. It was the culmination of the sort of finale in season 7. It's called the Frozen Lake sequence. And it really came from just a little drawing that was done, influenced by the script, but really kind of riffed off of this idea. Like, we just need to create a standoff between all the White Walkers and this huge anticipated moment of our heroes being trapped. in the middle of this ice lake. But as you'll see from one of our previous supervisors here describing the scene, we didn't have that much to go on. So check this out.
The Frozen Lake Rescue had to be designed and shot without a lake, dragons, or armies of the dead. The quarry parking lot set was transformed using LiDAR environment scans and elements shot on a dunk tank stage with multiple motion control passes. Positions for actors, cameras, and whites were worked out virtually, and digital artists added hero weather and a nice look for the ground plane. The dragon attack coupled more motion-controlled dunk tank work with previous stunt blocking and tech vis to synchronize flight path, flame path, and camera motion. We relied heavily on visualization to define camera start and end heights and how the dunk tank, green screen, and pyrotechnics passes would line up. Each strafe run was calculated based on the dragon animation, frame rates, and camera setups to be used. We programmed the motion base to replicate the movement of the CG dragon with the actress on green screen. We recreated pre-visualized camera moves using motion control with a motion base, as well as a true-scale static buck model of Drogon's torso. The same motion could be repeated with a flamethrower rig mounted to a Spider-Cam suspended camera for the dragon blasts. We visualized eyelines for actors on the green screen box set with the 2D fire composite and CG set extensions, completing the emotional shot. We brought the dragon crashing down, first in previs and then with full CG animation and atmospherics. We used an offset wedge on the motion base to provide extra degrees for the stunt when Jorah nearly falls off. The group flyaways needed two additional bucks and the triple solve to shoot the character elements and integrate real and CG imagery with the drone background plate. When Viserion is resurrected, the hero shot was captured in motion control using the dunk tank. To help plan compositing for the foreground and background whites, we tech-vised most of the shots in front of green screen. Props, including a weighted scale model, helped guide the performances as well as the animation in post.
So, we have any Game of Thrones fans out there? Hope so.
Definitely.
Awesome. So, this obviously has a profound impact on the entire crew and everyone who feeds into this and off of this, aka there's an arrow that goes into the previous process and one that goes out, because it informs all these people so that they know what the other departments are doing, how that all works together. So the art director will have all these wonderful tableau shots and different choices for the design of the set. And at the same time, we will have to compare that with how the costumes are coming along. And how does that work well with the choices for the background? Is it different? Is it complementary? They all learn a lot from this, and they can reach out and make small and sometimes very large tweaks to their plan based on what they see depicted in the common blueprint, which is known as the previs. And all of this for seasons 3 through 7 were done by 7 people on our team. So it's not like a ridiculous large crew. It's a team of really talented folks working a long time, embedded in this case, Northern Ireland, just tackling scene after scene and becoming kind of a hub of activity and communication with everyone. So we see a lot, and we also saw how much love, attention, and professionalism went into this series that everyone was rallying behind. The fans expected a certain level of quality, and we helped bring some of that quality and channeling all of that together into a common vision. I wanted to just briefly mention that we've talked a lot about film and television, but actually visualization works across a lot of different media. So it's about creating compelling stories in games, in virtual reality, and also in theme park attractions. You can see different examples of that here. They also do a lot of commercials. So So because of all these other things that we do with virtual tools in other areas, like for gaming, for instance, our clients often think of us as kind of a Q laboratory from using the James Bond reference. We're always trying to come up with new gizmos and different ways for our artists, our clients and those artists to grab the actual equipment that we put in their hands and take the reins and actually explore the world themselves and begin to make choices that will impact the story and the visual design. So that was what we were able to do on Game of Thrones. Is they trusted us so much that they gave us the ability to create new tools. For example, using virtual reality, we created something new called Pathfinder. Pathfinder is a virtual scouting tool, and I want to show it to you now so you get a sense of kind of where we're heading with this.
Virtual set scouting can work for any type of set. It can work for interior sets, sets out on the back lot, or sets built on a location. You can change the size of rooms, you can move walls or any part of the set. You can start to explore creative decisions to help strengthen the narrative that you're trying to tell.
What I want to do, I think, is move everything a little bit closer so it feels a little bit more crowded in here. This guy back here, I bet we don't even need him. One less building to build, that'll save us some money. We're gonna move this wall over here and remove this upper section above the door so we can see directly to the door. Okay, look at this room. Oh, this is fantastic. We can have our heroes coming through the door. The bad guys will be here, and much nicer staging. We can still get up here on the sides.
You can scout your virtual set just like you would scout a real set. You can use a virtual viewfinder to look at different possible angles inside of your set. You can set the viewfinder to be any camera or any lens that you want, and then save those images and review them later. With a virtual set scouting system, you can actually set up some simple blocking for the scene, and you can start to look with your viewfinder and figure out some angles and start to plan your coverage in that virtual world. Virtual set scouting is...
And so that's become a really popular tool, and we have lots of other different tools that we're constantly making out of our workshop that are helping solve problems that directors and their crews want to do as they seek to increasingly interact and change just about anything within the virtual plan. And also to change that while they're working live on set. So one of the first instances of this is with the awesome visual effects company Framestore. They invited us in, and it was the first thing that kicked off our collaboration to create an office in London. And they handled the technology that was surrounding the actor, and we handled the pre-visualization and some of the design that went into surrounding Sandra Bullock and George Clooney inside these boxes of LED panels that actually depicted the previs in real time so that it would actually help light the actors and make them feel a little more enveloped within that space scene. So for example, you can see here's some of the previs with some basic lighting. And we take that and project it on all the walls of this kind of crude TV box. And because of that, you get all this great interactive lighting. And of course, the camera is being moved based on the way in which the previous camera move was approved. And so we're able to work very closely with the DP, who's the award-winning Emmanuel Lebesky, otherwise known as Chivo, who always brought something extra special to this working with Alfonso Cuarón. Yet another example of a pretty highfalutin tale that was done by a real auteur filmmaker that really emotionally thought about every moment in the scene. just as much as I would think a filmmaker like Scorsese would put into every moment of their film. We witnessed it firsthand. Another series that's definitely a darling of ours and of the director is The Mandalorian. The showrunner of this is, of course, the great Jon Favreau. He's really awesome to work with because he's so inspired by what makes Star Wars really cool and wanted to help Disney Plus bring that to the streaming world. So I take it some of you, if not all of you, have seen these episodes, but you may not know that these are all done inside of a 3D or a volume of 360 LED panels. So what you saw from Gravity was a crude predecessor to what it has become now with this Lucasfilm and ILM produced stage. We're graciously invited into this world where we can help them create the assets that are displayed on this screen instead of just in a static way. They're displayed as a 3D model, a 3D, very realistic model that's produced or displayed and changed on the fly in real time by the Unreal game engine. That is the same engine that is behind your favorite games like Fortnite and many, many others. Okay, so when you're standing there inside this 360 volume of TVs, you're sort of basked in the light of the sunset or the environment. So it really does feel like the actors and the crew and all the equipment is just like in another world, perfect for a science fiction adventure movie. And I think you're going to be seeing a lot more of this type of cinematography being treated very seriously in the years to come. Right now, there's only one of these stages, and it's in California. So these are shots courtesy of the folks at American Cinematographer. These are straight out of their American Cinematographer article on this, which really broke the news that look at all the different variety that you can create out of these coves or psychs of screens and set the day, set the time. You can do interiors, exteriors. And so I want to show you this short clip that shows it in motion and really take notice of how the background adjusts in real time based on the correct perspective from the camera. And the camera is, of course, live operated, so it can be moved in any direction. It's not pre-canned. It's literally in real time, the background is responding to create the exact right perspective through the lens of the camera. And therefore, many of these shots can actually be recorded live and then simply shipped to the final version of the movie without any touch-up. In other cases, there's some final visual effects touch-up that happens, different things that are added and augmented. But I think over the years, you'll start to see this becoming more and more the final every single shot. So no need for post in the traditional way that people have posted. You'll just have to do all that work in advance and prepare it for the live exploratory process, much like what I described earlier. This is the happy accidents continuing live on set.
Bringing a live-action Star Wars TV show to the small screen has been an insurmountable challenge for decades. What has gone before theatrically dictates a broad array of unimaginable worlds that presents a fundamental scale problem for TV. To overcome the scale of sets and locations needed, our goal on The Mandalorian was to display final digital set extensions on a wraparound LED stage that seamlessly blended with our partial practical sets. The digital environment had to adjust perspective in real time to the tracked movie camera to allow the DP to move freely within the volume.
In order to help multiple departments understand how their work would be affected by this new approach, everyone worked together in VR during pre-production to block previs, scout sets, set decorate, and pre-light. The result would be a single 3D environment for everyone to reference. In the example of the Roost, we needed to provide the director and DP with a virtual hangar the size of a football field. Action would take place in three different areas over three shooting days. As we traveled from one end of the hangar to the other, we needed an exact match virtually and physically for anything that crossed over from the LED content to the physical stage. To accommodate this, physical set deck was constructed early in pre-production to allow the visual effects team to acquire a CG version through photogrammetry. Once the Roost hangar was approved, this virtual art department proxy set was then passed along to visual effects to be finessed, finaled, and performance tested in the game engine. Stage walkthroughs were an important step in the final approval process. It allowed the DP time to find shots originally visualized in the VR headset and pre-light accordingly, manipulating both virtual and physical lights. This melding of virtual and practical cinematography helped us bring the Star Wars cinematic universe to the small screen.
Okay, so that really brings us back to the seminal question that we've all been asking ourselves. I'm not sure how many weeks you've been asking yourself this, but I know it's been quite a discussion. And so I wanted to answer as best I could here based on my personal preferences and perspective. So as you've seen, everything that we've worked on is almost always a shot that is designed very purposely and is often cinematic. I guess, in my opinion, it uses the language of cinema in an artful way. And also the mise-en-scène or all the other things that the director can control in terms of blocking and staging the action. Most of the time, these shots are crafted with a great attention to mise-en-scène to support the narrative and to further the director's vision. The director has a conscious vision. It's not just like we need to get it in the can. It's literally every single scene has its own intent and is directed accordingly. And it really has the unique stamp of that particular director and the crew members and that all of that kind of adding up to the collective result. There's also a measurable impact on audiences that is visceral. It's not canned. It's a real human reaction. People are either gripping their seat or intensely nervous about the outcome, or they're often enraptured with the characters. And as we've seen in the tail end of the Avengers movies, it could be very emotional to people. And that's what any director really strives for, is to create those moments where people literally get lost in the cinematic vision and get really torn up by anything that happens to their beloved characters. And ultimately, I believe this really comes down to a personal preference for certain genres. You're saying that, well, yes, this is artfully done, but it's not my cup of tea. It's not the genre that I enjoy. So you're really talking about the story itself and not so much the cinema of envisioning that story. So that's kind of where I stand. And no disrespect, of course, to the great Martin Scorsese, who, you know, I absolutely worship in the form of of many of his films. I think in particular, the most impactful one for me was Goodfellas. I think that's pretty close to a perfect film in terms of its pacing, the innovative cinematography, the focus on individual characters, and that whole world and sense that he created was super artfully done. In some of the films that we work on, maybe we won't have as many opportunities to focus on a single character because there's, of course, a lot of different casts of characters in these expanded worlds. So you really have to be judicious about where you put your time. And it's a little bit of a mix of different emphases per episode. So sometimes we can't get as deep into that individual storytelling, but certainly, we look up to the the work of Scorsese, Spielberg, Bob Zemeckis, and others for how artful their storytelling is. And we try to, in some ways, homage that and, you know, and start to create cinematography that adds to the language of cinema over time, if we're lucky. So if you're saying that you don't like any of these movies for their storytelling, that's one thing. But just I would say that, you know, you'd have to really disagree with the statement that, you know, all of these guys are doing, you know, excellent storytelling that is artfully and cinematically based. These guys are also very engaged in movies of this genre, whether they be conscious superhero movies or definitely otherworldly adventures. All these directors and then some have done works like that. So I wanted to thank you guys so much for having me here. I know it's been a bit of a long intro, but hopefully you guys enjoyed it. And also wanted to turn it over to you. So if you're still hanging on there tonight, to ask some questions, and you're certainly welcome to please follow us and get back to us via these email addresses. In fact, if you actually want to send something to us just as a general question, you can send it to info@thethirdfloorinc.com. This is a slide from our business presentation, so it's a business ad, but it'll get to us regardless. And you know, please follow us on Facebook, LinkedIn, and also Twitter. We use this hashtag called Visualize It. We're trying to promote that. So with that, I am going to stop screen sharing and so I can see everyone. And I'm going to turn it over to you guys.
That was the most generous, mind-blowing. You just gave us the future of cinema. You gave us the future of movie making.
Thanks. Yeah.
You gave us this masterclass. Thank you so much, man.
That was incredible.
Oh, sure. I mean, thanks, Julian. I appreciate that. I mean, for me, this is obviously not a job. This is a passion. I started out being the guy that wanted to turn his Lego sets into something that was not on the box, on the cover of the box. I'm just using things for raw materials to create something new. This is something that I feel I can do today in an elevated way. The beauty of what we do, though, is it's so cool to just have different creators come in, and it totally changes the way we work based on their personal preferences. Some people like to roll up their sleeves and get in there and, you know, like, give me the virtual camera and do it this way. And they're like literally commanding like they normally do on set. And we have to be super fast paced with that and go, you know, solve their problems, especially when they're having like an existential crisis of like, how do I solve the third act? And I've boxed myself into a story corner of sorts. You know what I mean? We have to be there to talk them off the cliff. Other directors are a little bit more standoffish. They just want you to give it your best shot, and they want to see it in motion, and they'll sit back and watch the cut as if they're a moviegoer, and then they'll go, aha, I know what's wrong. Change this, change that, change this. Actually, I like this pumped up. Really like that. Actually, that gives me an idea, and here, let me tell you. So, and there's everything in between. So that's what's really, really fun is we get to see that perspective on a director's internal process that very few people get to see. And you might get to see it a little bit in a canned way on a behind the scenes, you know, which is kind of cool. But usually that stuff is done like in a canned, you know, it's done like after the fact and they're making up stuff or they're in an interview where they're supposed to say something cool and insightful, you know, like, but we get it like live at their moment when they're super fragile. Because anyone I know, if you guys are in the film program or an art program or anything, that you guys have probably been at that moment where you think your idea is great out the bat, and then you get into it and you're like, man, I hate it, or I've done something wrong, and why am I even doing this? And you have that like crisis. Directors have that all the time with us, even if they're like some of the world's best directors. Some are better at managing it, but ultimately we have to rally around them and give them that confidence, which is really just the fact that they need to see that mirror reflection of the work of art back to them. Sometimes it's so obtuse what they're creating, especially if they had to do it in so many different layers. It's so challenging to step back from the artwork and actually judge it. But thank God for the industry allowing us to like push the boundaries of this, because now we're getting that blueprint to the level where it's like, you can watch this thing like an entire preview of the movie even before the actors know that they're cast in the movie. You know, it's like, it's very empowering. And I think it's making an impact, not just on people in these really high-end blockbuster destined productions, but in small indie films, in certainly short films, in cases where folks don't have the opportunity to make a mistake because they have a limited budget, they have only so much time to do this and only so much crew that's going to pay attention to them for this short window. So that's what I see as the sort of ultimate outcome of this, is to hopefully inspire the next generation, you know, you guys, to say, I can do this partially myself. And when I get to a certain level, I can hire a small team, a band of brothers and sisters that can rally around my vision and help me optimize my flow.
Yeah, that's great. That's great. You know, I think we should dive right into student questions. So, so why don't we, everybody, go ahead and turn off your cameras. And I know Redelia is fielding the questions. Remember, students, if you have questions, you can send them to Redelia. And for those who are on the live stream, you can send questions right into the chat window and I can take a look at those. And so, so Redelia, who is our first question from?
Well, I'm still waiting on them to get geared up, but
you know what? That's because I didn't let them know that they could ask questions. And then all of a sudden, Chris Edwards just gave a master class, like a semester long master study of everything that is going to happen to movie making for the next decade. So if you have, everybody's mind blown too. So everybody's like, okay, so what? I don't even know what I just experienced. I just know it was important. So we have questions. I bet you somebody's going to have one pop up here really quickly.
Until we get there, I have one.
Great.
So you mentioned you use Unreal. That's your is that your preferred game engine as opposed over Unity? Or?
Yeah, you know, we are definitely partial to Unreal, partially because I'm really good friends with the guys that founded, you know, Epic Games. Mm-hmm. They came to visit us at Skywalker Ranch, and I had the pleasure of taking them around when they were just releasing their Unreal Engine version 3. Mm-hmm. And we became fast friends, and definitely had the same kind of spirit for the community that they were serving and my community that I was serving. Even though they're slightly different communities, we knew that there would be this collision of like the games world and the creators making cool stories there, and the filmmakers trying to make more and more otherworldly stories that started looking like games, like in The Matrix, you know. And we knew that there was going to be like this amazing synergy. So, long story short, we've been collaborating for many years, and so we get a little preferential treatment from time to time. Little extra love to help create some of those apps that we rely on for making this a little easier. So, okay. But definitely Unreal Engine is the base of all of our new pipeline tools, not just the VR, but everything we create henceforth will be done in Unreal.
Okay.
But also using Maya as a, of course, a driver of, you know, animation and assets that go into the Unreal Engine. But right now we actually have a, what we call a live link between Maya and the Unreal Engine that keeps them in sync. So you can create in Maya and then whatever happens in Maya happens also in Unreal.
Very cool.
Which is pretty darn cool. Yeah.
And so I have a couple of questions from students. So when I call on you, it'd be nice if you guys could turn on your face, if you're able to, so that Chris can see who he's talking to. So Anthony, you have a question. about live LED sets in the camera. Which Anthony is it asking that question?
Hello, this is Anthony Muldrow, ASU.
Awesome.
Yes, I had a question about the hello. Thank you for your awesome presentation. I greatly appreciate it.
Oh, my pleasure.
With the live LED sets, what kind of cameras are you guys using to capture that? Is it like a computer camera? Are you guys using like Arri's, like real cameras and stuff like that?
Yeah, definitely. Good question. Real cameras, it's the same cameras that the DP would have normally chosen. The only difference is we run tests on the refresh rate on the screen and lots of technical mumbo jumbo to make sure that the camera, the real film camera, like the Arri Alexa, is in sync with the background. So there's no sort of strobing. And that's, a lot of different settings that have to be, aligned to make that work. It's part of the secret sauce. So it doesn't look like you're just inside of a television world. But it's, we don't want to be in any way encumbering to the traditional craftspeople that are on set. It's all about, they can, you know, if there's a dolly grip pushing a dolly, use the same darn dolly they did on a regular stage. You can place lights the way you would normally place lights. You can set the camera for whatever setting, because really it's just, for the first time ever, you're looking at a background that has the same or similar lighting intensity to the real world. Used to be screens weren't actually bright enough to do that, if that makes any sense. You need to have the actual light coming from those very powerful bright LEDs be like the brightness of the sun outside, you know, if it's a sun scene, because that has to be bright enough to actually light the exposure in the camera, or else it would just look dim. Anyways, luckily it's like a collection of many different technologies that have recently gotten to the level where this is possible. You know, computers are fast enough to display that many pixels. A lot of the NVIDIA innovations made that possible. So you can string video cards together and have them process like everything in parallel. So you can have like almost limitless resolution. And it's the cameras being high fidelity enough to capture this. And it's the LED screens being fine pitch enough, meaning the actual dots on the screen are very, very tiny, just like a 4K television, but times, you know, it's something like 20K or something. It's, that it had to be that detailed in order for it to feel cinematic. So even though that started out kind of as a science fair project, it's now, I think, becoming a very viable way of doing things. And you heard it here first. I think it's literally the next couple of years, you're going to see a lot more of that. And by the way, I think it's going to be accelerated because of the unfortunate COVID crisis. Everyone's really affected in Hollywood, and we're trying to save as many productions as we can, and the artists behind those. Hopefully we'll be through it pretty soon, but everyone is really thinking twice about how much work can be done in a well-attended set. You know, that's a lot of people under intense conditions. So if maybe my bet is that people are going to, are already taking a closer look at virtual productions such as these LED screens and saying, actually it's not so bad, because we have actually a really tiny crew, but we have a lot of crew members that are virtual that are commanding things that you can control remotely via computer in different rooms, different countries. You could even probably have the director, if he or she wanted to, actually be in another location and having a virtual presence and be able to direct a scene live.
Wow.
So it's going to be cool. It is essentially the closest we can get to the holodeck right now. The next innovation after that is to allow the actors to start seeing the virtual elements they can see on the screen. So maybe like contact lenses or something with screens on them, but we won't talk crazy right now.
Okay, Chris DeMarco, you are up next. If you could turn on your mic so we can hear you.
Hi, Chris. How are you?
I'm great. Nice to meet another Chris.
Yeah. Hey, my mind is blown, by the way. So thank you for all of that, first of all. But I have a few kind of questions regarding, like, you know, I put it in the chat, but like, how often do you hire new people to work with you on Previz? What's most important to you in a new hire? You know, is there some sort of, I don't know, entry level kind of thing to work up in, you know, in the chain of, or, you know, where you, you know, your company and stuff like that?
Yeah. Well, I think the best way to describe that is to break it down by job a little bit. So, you know, most of the people we hire are in the sort of artist category, as in digital artists that know Maya and the basic skills of animation or modeling. We tend to break it in between both what we call shot creators, which are the animator and shot designers, you know, the composers of camera and layout within an animated scene. And then the other type of hire is a also equal in status is an asset builder. We didn't want to call these people modelers because they're not just making a model. They're building an asset. They're creating a world. They're bringing it to life, whether it's characters, props, environments, or all of the above. So the artists are the most people that we hire because they're the ones that are out in the field or at home base working hands-on with the clients. Also, surrounding those artists are the production team. And the production team can be anyone from line producers to production managers, coordinators, and such. There's a whole hierarchy of jobs in that area, which is equally important. Usually it's the previz supervisor who's like the head of the team, and they also report equally to the production person that's on our team too. And it's sort of a dynamic duo. Someone will be reporting to the clients and making sure they're on task, on time, and that the project gets done. And the other person is looking out for how can I give the best direction to my creative team. So there's opportunities there. And then there's also all the other kind of tech infrastructure teams that support folks, everyone from IT professionals that know how to make awesome servers and keep the computers running smoothly and installing software, all the way to like the R&D and pipeline coders that are making the custom technology, including virtual reality. So that's a job too. So there's a wide range of jobs. And to hopefully answer your question a little more specifically, what we look for within each of those is, first and foremost, a real good understanding of the film process. Everything you're doing here in school is actually, it really, believe me, it's going to actually pay off. I went to film school in upstate New York at a place called Rochester Institute of Technology. It was very hands-on. They didn't give me a silver spoon. I wasn't just going to USC and getting a job right away. I really had to learn how to make movies and how to collaborate with my friends. So we can sense your enthusiasm and your genuine love for cinema. That's, you can't teach that. It has to be ingrained within you. Around that, we need, like I said, basic skills, but hopefully you're a specialist in at least one area where you're like, I'm an okay modeler, but I'm a really good shot creator, cinematographer, or I'm a really good animator, but with a filmic mind. That's what we look for in that area. And of course, just, you know, producers, all the normal things, you know, just be really on task, really, really motivated, great communicator, super detail oriented. Coders and technology people, of course, we love it if they knew a lot about the game engine, in particular, how to problem solve and make tools. And so the more you can show a short sample of your work in any category, the better. We'd like to see the visual or technical evidence that you've done something great. It doesn't have to be a lot. It just has to be well done within the short sample that you have. We're only going to look at it for a short period of time, so make it good. Also write a cover letter when you send any of your stuff in or submit it in through the, we have a website and online submission process. Just send us your media, but definitely give us a sense of what you did in that media. It's all the usual demo reel tips and tricks. We just wanted to get to know you. And ultimately, we need to make sure that everyone who works at our company is very, very cordial, very appreciative of everyone around them. We have to have a good, wholesome culture. We have a policy where if anyone is disruptive to that, they just don't get it. I don't care how good they are. They just don't keep their job. And that's created a really kind of a safe space for everyone to be themselves. And that's important. It takes happy artists to make great work and to ultimately impress the clients and make them come back. Because they're usually really great artists too. And they want to work with people that can give them the ideas, not just sit around and ask for direction. They want self-starters. They want people who are motivated. They know how to stay in their lane when they should, but they are poised and ready like any good set PA to jump in, raise their hand, be assertive enough to say, I have an idea.
Well, That's exactly what, Scott Derrickson said when you guys were working with him on Doctor Strange, where, you're all's company came up just by coincidence as he was explaining and answering a question about his process of going from an idea to the final outcome. And he wanted to make a point that he really tries to take an idea from, a production assistant or from whomever is on the crew and to acknowledge those contributions. And so, when he started describing, I think it was the sequence, it was the mind trip sequence that Dr. Strange goes on. He essentially said, well, all this wild, crazy stuff was going to happen. And then the previous company I was working with, is how he described it, came back to me with all these incredible ideas, and we ended up using them. And so it's amazing how you'd have these great artists, because I think a lot of people, when they think of Previs, I don't know that everybody is thinking artists, filmmakers first. I think a lot of times the stereotype is, oh, these are programmers and coders. But it's so clear that there's so much amazing artistry and filmmaking going into what you guys are doing.
That's why I really felt compelled to, do this with you guys. And it's an honor, because I feel like I was the keeper of some secrets that weren't exactly obvious in the real world. Nobody really gets to see this side of filmmaking. And I just want to tell you from the inside of it all that it's a really inspiring place to be. And these superhero movies, just as a small genre within the giant pantheon of different movies that we do, are highly thoughtful about how they approach these movies. It's always story and performance first. And then everything else we do visually is sort of a complement to that that art, And so I just felt like I should speak up on behalf of all the great artists behind that. It's a huge, huge team effort. And, if any one person didn't pull their weight, it wouldn't be nearly as impactful. Chris, and Marvel, in particular, has been really great about nurturing that. I'm so thankful to be part of their family, because they're just so awesome with the amount of support they've given to us and to the whole community to say, just make it great. Just do whatever you need to do to improve the process film after film. And because they've trusted us and others, that's why I think it stands out.
Yeah, and Derrickson said the same thing about Marvel. Rodelia, I want to take a quick question from the live stream.
Okay.
Our friends watching over on YouTube.
Ooh, and we actually exciting.
We have a question from the ASU Entertainment Business Association students. who actually have a question in regards to
future third floor producers. Yes.
There you go. So it says, does your staff divide up work by character? How many characters do people create or work with?
Oh, I see. So when people are working on shots, the question is about how many characters they interact with when they're working on a movie?
I think the real question is, what's the workflow? I think there's an assumption that maybe your staff is divided up by the individual characters in the movie that they are animating. So how does the work get divvied up, I think, is the
fun question. Yeah, that's a good question. If that's what you guys are getting at, is that it really is a little different than the more of an assembly line process that a final visual effects company has to go through, because usually there's an entire workforce that concentrates on specific tasks. So there'd be like the tracking team is looking at those live action plates and making sure they understand how that camera was moving. And then they pass that on to someone who is setting up the shot. And then they pass it on to an animator who's just animating, not really caring too much about the final, texture on the hair. And anyways, you get the idea, and I know that you guys know that. So, but we consciously said, nope, we're going to break down the barriers between silos of departments, because that was my biggest thing when I was at Disney, is I was like, damn it, I want to animate, and I want to design shots, and I want to be making storyboards. And, after a while, they told me just to calm down and fix my attention on one activity at a time. But I always found ways to get in different things in, and but now that I control our world within the third floor universe, we set it up the right way, I think, which is everyone is working on pretty much a large variety of scenes. Almost everyone touches every character. It doesn't matter whether you're a junior or a super senior veteran who's been with me for 10 years, everyone gets opportunities to rise to the top, and everyone's ideas matter. And, so from a production standpoint, we're tackling scenes, maybe many scenes at a time. There'll be a section of artists working on a scene and another section working on another scene. But if, say, scene one finishes up early, well, then there's the shot creators on scene one will then go on to scene two to bail out the scene two people and pinch hit for a little bit and make sure that they hit their deadline. So that's kind of a little preview into the madness of a third floor producer's world, because it has to be dynamic. Like, if things change on a drop of a hat, which they always do, because someone, some parameters change against the filmmaker's will. The studio wants to rein the budget in. The audience test screening went a little poorly in one area because they thought it was, moms of this certain age thought it was too scary for their sons and daughters. So we need to go back in with a fine tooth comb and fix that. There's always a 911 kind of challenge. And so it's up to us to go, okay, from the producer and the previous supervisor to get together and go, okay, how are we going to do this? I don't know. Well, let's pull the audience, and then we pull the whole team together and we get ideas and we launch into a solution from that. So that's what makes it fun, I think, is to kind of tackle it like a SWAT team.
So, got it. Redalia.
Hopefully that gives you an idea.
Yeah, that helps a lot. Thank you.
Yes. Jessica Kahn, if you could turn on your mic and ask your great question.
Hi there. First, Chris, I want to say thank you.
Hey, Jessica.
I want to say thank you for the great presentation. That was amazing.
Hey, Jessica, did you turn your
camera on? You're welcome.
Oh, yeah. Here, let me do that. Hello. That's better.
Oh, hey, you're exactly like your virtual avatar.
Yes, exactly. And so kind of to bounce off that question that was previously asked, how long does animating a single like complex sequence usually take? It seems like you guys have a pretty full plate and have to do things pretty quickly. So I was just curious to what that process was like.
Yeah, I mean, sometimes we're under duress. We have to create a sequence in like 2 or 3 weeks all in. That usually involves multiple passes to scramble and get that sequence up on reels. A more luxurious way of doing it, and probably the preferred way, is to spend more like a month or a month and a half per sequence, unless it's like the big super centerpiece of the movie that's like all hands on deck, then that might linger on for many, many months. But this is where the third floor producers come in, because they can layer, you know, here's the big juggernaut sequence. It's going to take a little while. And then in between all the nooks and crannies of extra resource, we say, oh, we're going to do a little pickup shot here. And then there's that opening shot where the director keeps talking about helicoptering in to the building and he wants to get it just right. Or, you know, some particular aspect needs to be done a different way. There's also the switch between, you know, the creative brainstorming phase of pre-viz and pitch-viz, and then the, double check the calendar. Looks like they're going to go shooting in a month. So we got to start, even though we're still doing creative stuff, we're going to start putting people on tech-viz and some of the pre-planning stuff. There's usually like a separate SWAT team that knows that really, really well, because those folks have been out on set. They know how to communicate to the live action peeps. So it's about kind of keeping that going. So hopefully that gives you a sense. Usually when we're working on a big feature project, and we're doing, I would say, the majority of the movie, it's anywhere from 6 months to a year of work. Mm-hmm. And that's just for the, well, that's including the pre-viz, the tech-viz, the post-viz, and sometimes some extra virtual production that happens live on set, like those virtual previews or putting something on a screen so that it can be filmed live, like in Mandalorian. So we have to be like a Swiss Army knife, if you will, of like ready to adapt. And that's why it takes a particular type of person to want to really embrace that lifestyle. One thing I will say is that we certainly don't abuse our team members. Everyone gets paid for every single hour they work. We're not a sweatshop. All we do is we work during the hours that we're given, and we go home, we have families, we have lives, and we pet our dogs and come back all refreshed for the next big experience. But the corollary to that is, we all need to be darn fast at what we do, and we can't mess around during the day. So, you know, although we do have a lot of fun, we really are quite organized, and our pipeline supports that. And so everyone can just engage and be focused and work on their creative shot. We also tend to expect that each of our shot creators does at least one shot a day, usually more than one shot a day. That's usually from all the components that have been compiled. Obviously, if you're a junior, we're expecting a little less. And if you're a veteran, some people can do 10 shots a day. They're just awesome, you know? And that is, that's part of the magic of it all. But it's certainly the more comfortable you get with it, it's like playing a piano or playing any instrument. After a while, you just forget you're using all the buttons. You're just creating. And that's what we're trying to enable with the tools, particularly in the game engine. Yeah.
So here's what I want to do, because you've been so generous with your time. I know that there's probably, I want to get to as many questions as we can. I want to go into like speed round.
Speed rounds. Okay. Yes. Gotcha.
Speed round, so we can get to as many questions. I got a bunch of questions on the live stream. I'm sure Redalia.
Okay. Has short questions. Answers.
Yeah, no, listen, this has been so amazing. I would hate to end this with a student going like, oh, I wasn't able to answer my question. Jessica, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Awesome, Jessica.
Thank you, Jessica. Good question.
Okay.
Okay. You can iconify yourself now.
I have about three more on my end. So Julian.
Great.
I'm sorry, Luis Sanchez. Luis Sanchez. You're up next. Who are you, Luis?
Hey, Chris.
Hey.
I wanted to know more about the cinematography done on Gravity. I'm a big fan of Emmanuel Lubezki, and I know his cinematography in the past is very naturalistic and fluid, a lot of Steadicam kind of work. So was it hard for him to adapt to the pre-viz movement of the cinematography already being done going into production, or was he very on board?
He was definitely on board. I know he had to explore the possibilities like any good artist would. But he's just such good buds with Alfonso Cuarón, the director, of course, that they had a, you know, they have a free-flowing language between them. So if anything, this is one of those situations where we're just kind of on the sidelines watching the sparks fly of their ideas. And what we were giving them is a playground that was actually very limitless, where they didn't have to worry about the technology or anything too much up front. They, of course, were aware of it, but they weren't, I don't think that they, my impression was they weren't curtailing their idea because they worried it wasn't going to be possible. They were just riffing off of what would be the best shot. And then they'd let that go down the pike and deal with the ramifications later on. So I remember the very first scenes that we tackled, even before we were really had built all the digital models, we went out and got some, our team got some Power Rangers figures because they were the only things we could find that looked like dudes in spacesuits and were articulatable enough. And so we had those as a play set, and then they literally would just film with a tiny camera or their cell phone or something. You know, like, you know, it's like we go over Sandra Bullock as she just scrapes past the surface of the vehicle or of the spacecraft. And, you know, it'd be super rough, give us some idea, but then we'd have to go in and reproduce that. But oftentimes, from what I garner, because this was all happening in London, so I apologize, I wasn't there physically. But I heard a lot of stuff from our previous supervisor and some of the team members, how much fun that they had actually mimicking some of that using a virtual stylus. So we didn't have our virtual camera there, but we used like a joystick and different ways to change, to kind of move that camera so that it could be performed inside the software. And anyway, so I think that they totally went for it. That wasn't a very short answer. Sorry about that.
No, I appreciate it. That was good. That was actually good. Okay, next question. Redalia, what we got?
Julian, you've got a good question.
And be sure to turn on your camera if it's working.
Yes. Thank you.
First off, thank you so much. That was a crazy PowerPoint. I didn't know you worked so much from like Avatar all the way back to Star Wars. Also, I'm actually from Marin, so I'm back there right now, only a couple exits from.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah, so I'm
close. Okay.
I've seen a couple premieres.
Oh, I look forward to going back.
Yeah, but my question, just to be quick, is like, I know you guys done a lot of, you know, big movies, but also on like the smaller level, do you guys ever take like little proof of concept ideas or things people want to pitch or even just to like, you know, develop so they can have, you know, a product to pitch that's not just, you know, an idea that they're trying to, you know, either write out on paper.
Or... Yeah. We've done a lot of stuff on a much smaller scale. Most of the time, these are still like, you know, funded projects, but they're funded at a very small scale compared to like a Hollywood movie. They are just spending a small fraction, even like 1% of their budget on doing like a little pitch viz, because they need that in order to go get the rest of the 99% that they need for the movie. You know, we are trying so hard to get into a position where we can actually invest straight up in people's movies at an early stage, kind of like a seed fund in a Silicon Valley sense. So we're working on that. I don't have that to offer just yet to say the next generation of student filmmakers, but we're getting close to figuring that out. It's definitely, it would shift the paradigm of how Hollywood normally works. I like pursuing things that seem impossible, so we'll see. Wish me luck. But You know, definitely one of the things we're trying to do as a stepping stone to that is to prove that we can do our own original content. Because, you know, obviously we're part of the DNA behind these very successful movies. So there's a lot we could do if we just finished it off as an animated short. So we're starting that process now, even during the global pandemic. We're working on that. So hopefully coming to a streaming network near you, we'll have something new to announce. But if we can prove it, we could do it for ourselves, then we can definitely bring in guest directors and their ideas and maybe give them the chance of a lifetime to work with our team. And then we would become attached, if you will, as a kind of a minority co-producer of the idea. But obviously what makes the world go around and what allows me to pay for people's families and stuff is paying projects from the big boys. Mm. And I need some of that in fair proportion to the entrepreneurial pitch projects. But we're definitely, our heart is close to those. We want to do more and more of those over the years.
Awesome.
Wow, awesome. Thank you.
So stay tuned. Tell me when you're graduating.
Cool. Thanks, Julian.
Thank you so much.
Ian Flannery has a question.
Okay, Ian.
Oh, that's a close shot. Hi. Great presentation. And I'm wondering about...
Thank you.
This camera's in the worst position possible.
Well, you should have pre-visualized it.
I should have, but I can't pre-visualize without it being turned on. But anyway...
Exactly.
I'm wondering about your, you guys worked on the sequel trilogy of the Star Wars films, right? And I'm kind of interested in what role you guys played in like coming up with the set dressing, I'd call it. Like, I've seen lots of stuff that was cut from the movies, like ship designs and entire settings and such. And did you pre-visualize a lot of that? Or was that like done by a LucasArts development team before you guys?
You're saying like Star Wars Episode 3 and that sort of era of Star Wars? You're saying like the new stuff?
The newer ones, the sequels to the original.
Okay. Stuff. Like, so,
The like, Force Awakens, know, episodes, Last Jedi, yeah.
7, 8, 9, and Rogue 9, One, yeah. Some of those. Yeah. So those are big babies for Lucasfilm and the Disney universe that owns them now. It's approached similar to the way in which George Lucas liked to tackle things. Because one thing I forgot to mention is when we were on the third floor of Skywalker Ranch, we were on one side, and on the other side was the art department. Art department means not so much storyboard artists. In this case, it was mostly just people that were making concept artwork. Some of them were working as model miniature makers. So they'd like make a cool vehicle, or they'll make a clay sculpture of a Wookiee. And all of these things were potential designs for worlds, characters, props, etc. And looks and cinematic looks. So what happened is every day or so, George would come upstairs from his office on the second floor and have fun shopping for new influences in his own personal art gallery, curated by some of these amazing luminary artists that he already liked the style of. That was the art department, the hodgepodge band of brothers and sisters brought together to just influence him, riff off of his ideas in a 2D or stylistic way. So anyway, so that's what's happening even to this day, is that folks that are extraordinary visual artists come into the art department. They're usually rallied by the production designer, who is the overarching czar of the whole production look. And they'll start riffing off ideas and putting up boards, doing color scripts and all this stuff. And then they try to get the director to buy in on those ideas. But a lot of stuff, like you've noticed, falls by the wayside. That process, the lost leader, if you will, the edits that end up on the cutting room floor, all of that is good. It's part of the process, because the theory is if the director has chosen the ones that resonate with them the most, the ones they think are the designs that are the most indicative of the mood of the movie that they're trying to tell, then that's a better choice for the final product. And that all comes kind of a little bit before and in continuing in parallel with the previs. And increasingly now the previs teams have been interfacing in a substantial way with the art department folks, which is always very different every single time, but we're like taking their rough models and we're upgrading them or we're downgrading them to be more real time. And we start piling on other influences. So, yeah, hopefully that answers your question. But Lucasfilm is just a big scaled up version of that now. There's just a lot more people involved. But it's still the same kind of hand selecting of individual looks.
Yeah, no, that was really cool because that's part of what I wanted to get a little bit with that question, too, is how involved you guys are with the production team versus, you know, you get the designs in and you just have to produce assets from. And that was really insightful. Thanks.
Oh, thanks. Yeah.
Awesome, Ian. Let me take one from the live stream over here. You know, this
Adam, watch out. There's a helicopter behind you. Sorry.
I know. I got all kinds of virtual. I got all kinds of virtual backgrounds that I can show you, man. I got Doctor Strange. I got this dude.
Oh, thanks, dude.
Or I can just go to the...
Oh, yeah. That's one of my favorites.
I really like the virtual background. I think it's good. So I'm going to go over to the live stream for a sec. Question here was, do you think, to some extent, pre-visualization might diminish the role of a cinematographer or an art director? That's a provocative question, but a good one.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
No, I'm glad you asked it. It's oftentimes someone always thinks this in that maybe we're upstaging one of the collaborators or many of the collaborators in the film process. And that would be true if we were doing everything for everybody. But the idea is that actually all of these folks, there's still a cinematographer, there's still a great editor, there's still a production designer. No one has been displaced. We're just actually, our job is to listen to every single one of them. Like our movies would not be nearly as good if there wasn't all these traditional artists and supervisors and department heads kind of like driving it. But they also have invited us into the family. So sometimes we come up with ideas that maybe influence them. So it's a little bit of a balanced approach. I think in the early days when I was really trying to just establish previs as a thing, as a process that was accepted, it was definitely looked upon as with some skepticism. And I had to evangelize a lot and show the case studies and find those filmmakers that were as ambitious as like Robert Zemeckis and those guys that were just like, hell yeah, let's do it. I'll put all the technology into it. But then over the years, it became easier and easier, and there were less and less naysayers, and more people bought in and said, this is pretty cool. For some people, it actually needed to reach a level of quality that they felt was approximating cinematic realism, you know? And they know that, hey, this is just a rough draft. It doesn't have to be, like, super polished. But if they were just looking at, like flat shaded polygons and it looked like Tron, then they're like, too obtuse. That doesn't feel like a photograph to me. It's not cinema. Even though maybe the ideas behind it were actually cinematic. So it definitely took some time for that technology and the process to get detailed enough. And then they all of a sudden started, even the folks that were hesitant to engage, they all of a sudden started going, well, sign me up. Actually, I had a good experience. It's also hard to control, too, because it's not like we're the only previs company on the planet. There are lots of people. Anyone can do previs. You have to fight against the folks that have had or the clients that have had bad experiences for whatever reason, where their previs team didn't know how to translate their ideas onto an on-set location. So they ended up painting themselves into a corner and feeling like, oh, this previs just led me astray. And now I have even less time to work on my project. So it's definitely something like anything that any process in filming that has to be done very thoughtfully. And you can't just rush through it. You can't do it in a super amateur way or else it's going to come back to bite you. So.
Got it. Yeah. Excellent. So listen, I think you've been like, we've been on a total tear, man. We're on to 2 hours and 15 minutes. I think we're going to take one final question. You've been so generous with your time. Do we have one final awesome question with somebody who has a camera that that Chris can see for this final question? Adalia.
There's not one from over here. Okay. From our group.
Okay. All right. Well, then I can, so if there are no questions from the Zoom side, I'm going to reach over to the live stream. And another really good question, actually, from one of our colleagues, Nora Cherry, who works on the staff of ASU, who was so interested that she decided to go to the live stream, and she helps us with our recruiting of students. And
it's just wonderful.
A total positive force in the universe. She's got a great question. She has a dance background herself. And she had asked, how do the actors respond to performing emotionally in a virtual reality?
Well, this is an interesting one because a lot of people thought that maybe the actors, for example, on a movie like Avatar would like just eventually, you know, just like hate the process. I think from what I've seen and heard, there is definitely a transition period where they have to learn how it's all going to translate to the virtual characters, the virtual avatars that they're playing. But once they get into it, they're able to do the same level of performance that they can do if they're, you know, in a scene that has no visual effects, because they're great performers and they know how to focus on that moment as if they're doing a play. You know, it's nerve-wracking to be surrounded by a crew anyways when you're doing any kind of shoot. It takes a real actor to block all that out and be in the moment. So that all those professional actors know how to do it very well. What we try to do as a crew is actually, especially on more emotional moments, get everyone away who doesn't need to be essentially right there, so that it is a little bit more focused on that performance. Virtually, though, the biggest transition is to have those actors understand how they're going to interact with anything that's digital. So the first thing is like, you know, where am I standing and what can I touch and what can I not touch? That's where it used to be very rudimentary, very rough to give feedback in real time back to the actors. Nowadays, things can be a lot more immediate. For example, with the LED screens, or with composites that they can see that are real time. So they may go in and do a performance and they go, oh, actually, I see in the playback how that's coming off. Let me try it again. So it's definitely something that more actors will need to get some more experience with, because I think it's going to be not the outlier. It's going to be, you know, part of the norm. Mm-hmm. Not that everyone has to play digital characters. That'll happen on occasion. But it really is, I think a lot more actors are going to be experiencing situations where they're at least acting within a virtual environment with different things that aren't apparent in the moment that are going to show up in the final version, like on The Mandalorian.
Got it. All right. What a marathon. This was amazing. Everybody turn on your camera. Turn on your camera, people. Yes.
Hey. Oh, you made it to the end. Thank you so much for spending your precious pandemic time with me. You can now all go back to your video games and binge watching of Mandalorian episodes. Don't forget to eat. And also, if you guys are really into this and want to follow us, please do that via our website. We have we would just love for you guys to sign up for our newsletter. We send out these kind of behind the scenes announcements on all the stuff we're doing. Sometimes there's links to cool videos and whatnot. That's a monthly newsletter. I think you can sign up for it right on our website, The Third Floor Inc. or INC, like incorporated.com. And as we said, if you have any other questions, you can send it to info@thethirdfloorinc.com. Always happy to hear from you. If you're into getting a gig with us, especially after you're graduated or about to graduate, please send us a little heads up on that. And maybe I think the best way to do that is through the website. There's a careers section, and you'll see all of the different jobs that are currently we're recruiting for. And yes, we are still recruiting, even though a lot of people are out of work, unfortunately, in Hollywood. So it's definitely a bright spot that I think will lead to some good career growth. So thank you for considering that. And thank you, Adam, so much. Thank you for everyone who put this together. Thanks to Lorenzo, the awesome gatekeeper of the internet. And thank you, Idalia. I really look forward to getting to know your work over in Santa Monica College and all the other students that are there. Maybe we could do something with you guys soon.
Absolutely. Definitely.
Yeah, let's do one last. Everybody turn your microphones on. We're going to do one final mind blown. 3, 2, 1.
Mind blown.
Give the man some applause, people.
Thank you.
Thank you,
guys.
That was awesome.
Thank you. Good questions. You guys are awesome. Really appreciate it. I don't live stream very much, so this is a particular honor. Thank you so much for your attention, your interest. Thanks for being fans of great cinema. I look forward to whatever final reports you guys are going to put together. feel free to quote me, but only when I say good, provocative things. And thank you so much. And everyone stay safe out there. I know it's tough times. This too shall pass.
Yes.
Definitely it's always a happy Hollywood ending at the end of these endeavors.
Yeah,
somewhere out there is coming.
Stay positive, everybody. You know, President Crow, when he signed off his video message, when he was talking about this situation, he actually pulled a movie reference from Alien. And reminded everybody to stay frosty. Stay frosty, everybody. And stay safe.
See, that's the one thing we got to remember is that during times of war, during other, recessions, depressions, you look at the statistics, that's when humanity goes to the distractions of the world. The stories, they retreat back into entertainment. They need it more than ever, and to keep our humanity going. And that's really what all of these superhero tales are saying to us. It's about humans in this super elevated, exaggerated way through their superheroes that they strive to be or strive not to be. In the case of the villains, that's why these are so important. We take it very seriously. It's not just popcorn entertainment. This is hopefully meaningful to a lot of folks. And, we don't have Comic-Con this year. Unfortunately, we're going to wait a whole nother year. But if you've either been to Comic-Con or know what I'm talking about in San Diego, this every time I go, my faith in humanity goes up like a couple of notches just because I see how many people are able to express their fandom, their interest in whatever floats their boat. And it could be such a variety of things. But just to see the mass talk, like popular culture of everything kind of clashing, coming together, it makes you realize, wow, this is actually pretty important what we do. maybe not as important as government things and military stuff and farmers making food for us to survive. But just one notch below that probably is, you know, keeping our psyches together and exploring these thought-provoking topics. Thank you.
Cool, man. Well, thank you again so much. We really do appreciate it.